Senator Tom Carper from Delaware is the chairman of the Committee on Environment and Public Works, an early champion of the infrastructure bill. Senator Carper worked in tandem with his Republican counterpart, Senator Shelley Moore Capito of West Virginia, to get the support of colleagues in the Senate. I had the chance to interview him just a short while ago.
Senator, thanks so much for joining us. Look, as chairman of the Senate Committee on Environment and Public Works, let me just ask you what it feels like at this moment after so many years. Now we have an infrastructure bill that has been signed into law. It's going to happen, $1.2 trillion. What is it going to look like to the person out there on the street, the family at home, you know, workers out there? What does this mean for the country?
What it means is, among other things, when people turn on their faucets, more likely than not, they'll have clean water to drink. They won't have to worry about the safety of their families. When they go outside, we're going to be reducing emissions, all kinds of emissions, including car emissions, but the air that we're going to be breathing, and particularly in neighborhoods that were communities of color, we're going to be reducing those emissions, and not just carbon dioxide. The potholes, and you know, I think we spend as an average like $450 a family across the country on car repairs, truck repairs, because of the damage it's done to their vehicles by our roads, highways, and bridges. We spend almost two days a year just sitting in traffic, sitting there, not going anywhere, putting out emissions and so forth. So the idea of reducing that dramatically is part of it. This is the largest investment in mass transit that we've ever done in the history of the country. It's the largest investment, I believe, in roads, highways, bridges that we've done. We've got tens of thousands of bridges. People drive across bridges. There's probably about a 10% chance that the bridge that you're driving across in this country is unsafe. And we're going to go after those in a huge, huge way and make them safer. So there's a lot of ways that this will touch people. The other thing it'll do is put a lot of people to work. A lot of people to work, not just for a couple of weeks or a couple of months or a couple of years, but for the next decade or so.
Let me ask you, Senator, we have a mutual friend, one of the major donors to the Democratic Party, Bernard Schwartz. And I've been talking to Bernard, you know, for more than a decade and a half, and he has been, you know, laser focused on the needs of infrastructure for this country. And the price tag he had on it was $2 to $3 trillion. $1 trillion sounds like a lot, but I guess my question to you is it? Are we going to be seeing that after this round of funding and this level of investment in the country is done, that we're going to have to come back pretty quickly for a round two?
No, actually, I always like to quote Abraham Lincoln. He used to say, what is the role of, when people say, what is the role of government, Mr. Lincoln? He'd say, the role of government is to do for the people what they cannot do for themselves. Sometimes we talk like this entire responsibility is on the federal government. It's not, this is a shared responsibility. It's a responsibility that we share with, among others, state and local governments. As a former governor, I know full well that there's a huge responsibility on states and local governments. I met just yesterday with a number of folks who run and operate hundreds, thousands of convenience stores across the country. They're going to be putting in charging stations and ultimately fueling stations for hydrogen-powered vehicles as well. This is a shared responsibility, and we'll be using the tax code to incent them to do that, but not to pay for all of that with taxpayer dollars. So think of this as an investment to leverage even more money from the private sector, state and local governments, that's, I think, the more accurate way to do this.
You know, another dimension of this infrastructure bill, which is interesting, you know, for someone who's been following, is it's not just highways and bridges and roads, but also broadband and connectivity in a way. And, you know, I've been to Delaware, I spent a lot of time in Delaware, and to be honest, you know, connectivity, like everywhere else in this country, is uneven in the state of Delaware. Is this bill going to help even that out? You talked about communities of color and other communities that have been left on the, you know, sidelines of a lot of the progress we've had. I guess the question is, when we kind of think about how important it is to be digitally connected, is this infrastructure bill going to solve that problem?
Great question. We were reminded during this pandemic of the fact that, just as you say, there's a lot of rural areas, not just Delaware, but 49 other states where people don't have very good connectivity. There's a lot, frankly, a lot of urban areas where people don't have good connectivity. And that's the bad news. The good news is we can do something about it. The other thing I would add is that this is not all on the federal government. This is a responsibility that we share in Delaware and 49 other states, where the federal government will provide a fair amount of money to incent and to leverage a whole lot of other money from state and local governments, from utilities, and from communities. So, when you put it all together, it is huge, and I'm excited about getting started. it's one thing to pass the legislation, and it was not easy. It's been hard. It's been years in coming. We've gone through, in the last administration, every year there's like Infrastructure Week. Well, we talked about it, but we never actually passed any meaningful legislation. Now we've passed it, and the key is, how do we implement it? How do we make sure that the federal government does its share and incentivizes and leverages a lot of private sector and private money?
Okay, I know this is a big question, but you and I were just talking about my former boss, Senator Jeff Bingaman, and I worked for him in the 1990s. And Jeff, you know, was very worried that things like the Highway Trust Fund, this is in the 1990s, were eventually going to have diminished revenue sources for infrastructure, because we were going to bring electric vehicles on. We were not going to be able to depend on gas taxes if we succeeded in moving away from fossil fuels. And Jeff used to talk about this, Senator Bingaman used to talk about this. And I guess now we're there. So I guess my question is, where are we with the issue of trust funds and the way we've been funding them, like highways? Does that need a makeover, or does this bill help get us there? Because I know this is in your terrain. I just haven't followed where we are by way of beginning to think differently about how we fund these long-term commitments of infrastructure in the future.
Yeah, for a long time, I've said, as governor and as chairman of the National Governors Association, in my role in the Senate, that things are worth having or worth paying for, that those who use, among other things, our roads, highways, bridges, have an obligation to help pay for them. And in our legislation that's been signed into law, there is what we're going to be doing a pilot, not just in one or two or three or four or five states, but literally in all 50 states, a pilot to look at vehicle miles traveled. So regardless of whether folks are driving a hydrogen-powered vehicle, electric-powered vehicle, or gas or diesel-powered vehicle, they will pay a fair amount of money into the transportation trust funds for going forward. That's probably something that won't occur in this administration, but I think it's very likely that it will come in future administrations, and it should. It's fair, it's equitable, and frankly, it's an efficient way to pay for our roads, highways, and bridges.
Senator, you know, this is kind of unfair. You know, you have like the American Society of Civil Engineers comes out and gives states grades on their infrastructure. And I feel like, you know, it's kind of unfair. But, you know, a state like Delaware and many other states didn't get very good grades from the society. And I'm just interested, after we see the partnerships unfold, after we see, you know, the state and local and the government come in, we see the jobs that are created and coming around. What do you think is an appropriate expectation of moving up that graded scale? Say, if a state is at a D level, will we get up to a B or an A level, you expect, in, say, the next 10 years? Because this doesn't happen overnight, folks. This is going to take a while to make the big, serious investments that are being laid out.
Yeah, if the states take the responsibility to be incentivized themselves and to join the federal government with roads, highways, bridges, and transit and that sort of thing, we'll see big movements. Will be in 10 years from now. Those that are in the D category, I think, have every expectation to be up to C or maybe even higher. The good news is we're going to reverse the trend that has been in place for years, going, you know, from bad to worse. That's going to turn around. And to the extent we can have this partnership built on the partnership that exists under the law that's incentivized, we'll do a whole lot better. And we need to. This is a wonderful opportunity here. I'm excited about it and thrilled to have had a chance to work with Shelley Capito from West Virginia, my native West Virginia. We're both two of the West Virginia kids, and to get this done together and work with the administration. The president hadn't pushed for all this stuff. This would never have happened.
I had dinner one night with Senator Capito, and you guys were all out there negotiating like this. And, you know, she gave us a snapshot of the intensity of it all. What was it like being on the forefront of these negotiations? Because you have different wings in the party that felt differently about this. I guess my bottom line question is, why was it so hard?
This is the largest infrastructure package, I think, maybe the first or second largest infrastructure package in the history of the country. That's why it's hard. And it's hard because you got a 50-50 Senate, and our friends on the other side of the aisle aren't always interested in getting things done, and sometimes maybe in embarrassing the current administration or those of us on the Democratic side. I think it was Churchill who used to say, democracy is the worst form of government devised by wit of man, except for all the rest. This is a tough way to govern. And we're seeing that proven all over again. But the good news is we got it done. It's been signed into law. And then now the challenge and the opportunity is for us to implement the legislation well, make sure that we do good things for our planet, our environment, and also make sure that we create a whole lot of jobs. We have the chance to do both. And this is one that I think we're going to do both.
You know, Senator, one last question. You know, I've interviewed, you know, I've got a lucky job. I get to talk to governors, mayors, and they're so excited about this infrastructure bill.
Now you're talking, Steve, to a recovering governor. So.
Yeah, recovering governor. Well, I mean, I'm always interested in the governor's caucus in the Senate. They have a very different orientation than people that haven't been governor, because you guys have been chief executives. You want to run and, you know, manage things. So I find that very, very interesting. But
Steve, if I had a dollar for every time I said before my colleagues, when I was governor, everybody would throw it out the window.
Well, I think another dimension is when I talked to them about this bill, I said, what's most important to them about this bill? And they said, they hope that the federal government understands how important it is for local communities to figure out how to massage this money in the right directions and how to do that. And I guess my question to you is, you know, if you were to give a friendly bit of advice to Secretary Buttigieg or to President Biden and his team about how they go about implementing this now, you know, where do you think the gaps are going to be? Do you think they're going to hear that message from, you know, local mayors and state governors that they've got to have some local control and direction in this?
One, let me just say the legislation we passed is not written in stone. It's legislation, and they're going to be implementing it. And to the extent that there are things that we need to tweak, we need to hear from states, and I'm sure that we'll hear from governors, but we'll also hear from mayors. Remember, before he was Secretary of Transportation, Mayor Pete was Mayor Pete. Mm-hmm. And so he thinks, maybe not as a former governor, but as a former mayor, and a lot of the transportation operations around the country are municipal transportation operations. So he's had a lot of time to think about this, and I'm sure he'll look out for the states and the governors and the mayors, and so will we on behalf of the folks we serve.
Well, I really want to thank Governor Tom Carper. Oh, wait, Senator Tom Carper.
It's Mayor Pete. It's Mayor Pete calling now.
Well, give him our regards. And but Chairman of the Committee on Environment and Public Works, you know, Senior Senator of Delaware, thank you so much for joining us. And thanks for sharing with us the insights into how this bill came into being. Thank you, sir.
Thanks. Come and see us in Delaware. The streets won't be paved with gold, but they'll be well paved. And we'll have a lot better transit going forward, too.
That's a deal.
Take care. God bless.